How are you? Galing. Sarap mag sarap pala ng singles ng Kristiyano, no? Pag Saturday night, ganito ang gimmick. Oo. Hindi ko nadatnan yung ganito eh, nung single pa ako. Yun. But can I ask you to join me in a word of prayer before we start? Okay. Father God, I just praise and thank you for working all things together for the good. We know that there are no accidents, that everyone is here for a purpose, including myself. And I just lift up to you, Lord Father, everything that I'm going to say. I'll override my preparation, as they say, because it's true. I need you, and I depend on you, Lord Father, to speak through me, to speak to the hearts of the people who are here. I thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in our lives. We praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, thank you for inviting me to tonight's Workability series. And I want to thank Brother Mark for inviting me. Let's give Mark a big hand and the team. Thank you. Si Mark, kasama ko yan sa D12 ko, sa D group. Oo. So, minsan, nakahabata. Kaya lang pag nag-i-email siya sa akin, sabi niya, Tito Ardy. Ang tawag niya sa akin. I want to thank also Philip, my parang inaanak ko na rin yan, no? So let's give Philip and the team a big hand. Thank you very much. Okay. Before we start, I want you to look at the person next to you, if you have someone next to you or behind you, okay? And give them, look at them and give them a sincere compliment, okay? Oh, look at them. Oh, yeah. Sincere compliment. Kung di mo kilala, o ako. Pag wala kayong masabi, wala kayong makita, sabihin mo lang maganda yung buhok nila. Ganda ng buhok mo. Pag walang buhok, sabihin mo maganda ng kilay. Okay. How does it feel to be complimented? Good? Good, good. You know, there is this professor in the University of Chicago. In the late 1950s, he experimented with this concept of creating a compliment club. Okay? And he told his students, average students, who were like C or D students, and said to them, okay, find something to compliment. Find five classmates or people to compliment every day. Okay? And you know what? They found that this principle worked wonders because after a semester, the grades of the students started to increase from average of C, D, naging A and B plus students na sila. And it's the same thing also in the workplace. When supervisors, when workmates started complimenting each other, trying to find something, a sincere compliment, ni puro bola, na ang ganda ng shorts mo, ang ganda, di ba? Ganda ng legs mo, puti-puti. Di ba? Pero sincere compliment, yun, productivity increase. Naalala ko kasi nabasa ko yung, I don't know if that's part of the breakout group later, but it's true. When you compliment someone, you feel good, right? There is this, the professor also shared this, this professor is a psychologist or psychiatrist, and he holds a clinic also. So what he did, he started implementing this compliment theory among his patients. And there was one patient that approached him one day and told him, doctor, you know, I have this problem. I don't know what to do. It's really bothering me. I work for this big company. I work as a secretary. And my boss, you know, he's so difficult, he's so masungit. Every time, he's so critical of me. No matter how hard I work, he always finds something wrong with what I do. I really want to resign. I don't know. I mean, how many of you have had bosses like that? Yeah, quite a number, yeah. I've experienced that also. But, so she asked for advice. What should I do? Should I resign or should I start looking for work? Because it's really stressing me out. And what the doctor's advice to the secretary was this, sabi niya sa kanya, before you resign, try this. For the next 60 days, give your boss a compliment every single day. No matter how hard it is, just find something that you can compliment him about, something sincere. Make sure it's sincere. So with a heavy heart, I mean, okay, sige, I'll try. No matter how hard it is, difficult it is. So she started. One day, she said she was taking dictation. This was the 50s, so wala pang ano, di ba? So she was taking dictation, and she would say, "Boss, I really appreciate the way you give dictation to me. Your words are pronounced so clearly." You know, so. Okay, so next day, "Boss, I really like the way that yellow tie looks on you. It really brings out, you know, it really brings out the best." So every day, "Oh, boss, I heard that you won, your team won in the golf tournament. And, you know, I'm really proud of you. The office is really proud of you." And then another day, she would find something to compliment her boss. And after 60 days, she didn't go back to the psychiatrist. Instead, she went back about after 3 or 4 months, actually about 5 months. And the doctor said, "Oh, what brings you here? Did you resign from your job? What happened to your boss? What?" And she said, "Actually, yeah, I'm resigning. I'm resigning next week. But that's not the reason why I'm here, because I want to give you an invitation, because I'm resigning because my boss and I are getting married." True story. So after 5 months, the boss proposes to the secretary. Okay. So if there's anything you can take away from this talk, you singles, remember the compliment club, okay? All right. So we're going to talk about 5 lessons that I learned that you can depend upon. And I base this on experience, and I base this on the Word of God. And my prayer is that you'll learn something from this, even one thing that you can apply. And I know that we're only here, we have this place only until 12 midnight. Yeah, so we'll start, okay? So again, my name is Ardy Roberto, and I was single for some time. When my first wife passed away, I became a widower. But by God's grace, got married last year. And I want to acknowledge the presence of my wife. Okay. So Joshua, can you also raise your hand? Hello. Yeah, Joshua's prayer was answered, because when his first mom died, he said, "Lord, I pray that you give my dad a new wife, so that I can have a new mom." So that was his prayer. Yeah. So they exchanged vows during our wedding. But you see, when the introduction, you hear the introduction, and today, you know, I basically lost all my identity, because now I'm known now better as the ikaw yung asawa ni Miriam Kimbao. Tapos tinatago kong inspirational speaker. Dati hindi naman. Sabi ko, bakit? Puro sa press releases, Miriam Kimbao is engaged to inspirational speaker. Miriam Kimbao is married to inspirational speaker. I never really was an inspirational speaker. I'm more of an author, and I get invited to speak. Pero I realized that when you look kasi at me and my wife, and then people look at me, then they look at my wife, then they look at me, then they look at my wife, they're so inspired na. They remember this verse: "With man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible." Amen? Ayun. But truly, I live an inspiring life because we have an inspiring God, right? He is truly capable of inspiring and impossible things. And I praise God for this chapter in my life. And another miracle that he's done in my life is that my work, my calling in work is an author, really, my first calling. And I praise God for the books that he has caused me to write that have become very popular. And a long time ago, when I was starting to write, I would go to a national bookstore and I'd see all the books that were there. They're all about New Age, Feng Shui, they're all about this and that. I'd say, "Lord, sana one day, you know, there'd be a time when Christian authors would be here on the top sellers." And then this book, Pera Na Hindi Bitin, paved the way. After that, you know, more people got exposed to books, and now there are many Christian authors who are now in the top 5 or top 10. And this book, Pera na Hindi Bitin, was in national bookstore, if you sell like 4,000 copies a month, you're a bestseller na. But this book, praise God, it sold about 150,000 copies in the first, yes, praise God. Praise God. And I thank God for my mom who bought 149,990. What would you do without your mom, diba? No, but really, seriously, it was really a blessing. The last book I wrote is Real Men Are Pogi, reached number 5 before it also ran out of stock. And yun, I'll tell you more about that later. Okay? Yeah, Real Men Are Pogi. Okay? And aside from an author, I was also called by God to, I was an employee for about maybe 10, 12 years before jumping into the entrepreneurship bandwagon. And I was, my first wife and I, we started Salt and Light Ventures. And after 6 years in the business, we were among the top 10 entrepreneurs, mainly because of some high profile events that we put together, which I'll share with you. But you know, you hear the introduction to me and you hear all of these highfalutin credentials, pero you don't know what happened in the background, how I got there. And this is my real resume. I don't know if you can hear. My real resume, I started as a student. I was a working student. I sold fire extinguishers. I went into ballet. I was a ballet dancer. Yeah. Guys. No, but guys, you know, at that time when I was in high school and college, because that's where you find the girls. And there's no other men who would dance, who would partner with them. So, yun, tip lang yun. Pero yun. So I actually went out and I was being encouraged to go out on a career as a ballet dancer. Pero hindi nangyari. Buti na lang. Assistant cook. I went to the States as an exchange student and during my spare time, I would work. I found work as an assistant cook. I was cooking honey-baked ham. Yung ham pala, ang pagluto nun, ano yun? Torch. So, bababa namin yung mga hamon, lalagyan lang namin ng asukal, and then we would torch it. Yun. Honey daw yun, honey baked ham, tapos lalabas na sa deli. Mahal-mahal. I experienced working as a gardener on weekends, telemarketer, mail clerk. I was even a U.S. Army test subject. You know? So, okay, well, I spent a few minutes on that. Sige. U.S. Army test. During the times when I was in college, in the States, wala pang internet, no? So wala pang mga... So I would always read the bulletin boards looking for jobs like that, like gardener, etc., etc. That's where I would find all the jobs. One day I saw there, volunteers wanted by U.S. Army test subjects for sleep deprivation study. You know, sleep deprivation. So tawag ko, what is this all about? Oh, you'll be paid something like $700 to volunteer not to sleep for 7 days. 7 days. Sabi ko, puyatan, sanay na ako dyan. So sige, sali ako, $700. I said, I had a girlfriend then and we wanted to go to Orlando, to go to Disneyland. So sige, this money was enough to buy, you know, to go to Disneyland. Okay, so I joined. There were like 12 of us, a dozen students, volunteers who joined. And we were in this army facility in Virginia or Maryland, I forgot. But yun, papasok kami sa facility. We won't know, you don't have any washroom, we won't know the time of the day. And they'll just let you play Monopoly, you'll watch all the videos that you want, play video games. And then once in a while, they'll call you to a room and then they'll put these attachments on you to test if you're still okay. And then they'll test your, eye-hand coordination. And they were testing this placebo versus this control substance. Ayun pala, they were testing the effectivity of nicotine on nicotine tablets on their, so that they were planning to give it to their to the army staff or personnel who were in the foxholes niya. Hindi natutulog ng isang linggo. So I didn't know, maybe I got the control because I really didn't sleep for the whole week and there were only 3 of us left and I did get the $700. Okay, so my girlfriend picked me up. We went to Disneyland with a friend, a chaperone, and the friend, my girlfriend and the chaperone really enjoyed themselves because all I did was sleep. Yun. So I also went, when I went back from the States to home, encyclopedia sales. I worked as an editor for an NGO, editorial assistant for Metro Magazine when it was newly launched, production manager. I set up an import-export business as a president, which closed down after 6 months. I was a consultant. I did film documentaries. I was a manager in a magazine for special projects. So, dahil kumpleto naman pinasukan, nag-retail shop pa ako, nag-concert promotion pa ako. I wanted to be the Playboy magazine publisher of the Philippines. Set up a direct marketing agency, direct sales, entrepreneur, finally author, and all those other credentials. And so my journey in the work area has been really colorful. I could call it an adventure. Okay, so I'll share with you my work adventures and the lessons that I learned. Okay, konting story about that. Baka iba sa inyo nagugulat yung mga first timer, right? Ba't pinapaturo yung ano, Playboy publisher, parang. Pero I really, when I was young, when I was in college, I wanted to be the Playboy publisher of the Philippines. That was my ambition before I met God, before I met the Lord. And my ambition was to, my plan was to get the franchise of Playboy magazine and bring it to the Philippines. And this was the time in the 1990s when when I went to Stanford. My company sent me there to study professional publishing. So nagkaroon ako ng network ng mga New York publishers, etc. And then they were talking about bringing like Cosmo, Elle, Sports Illustrated to Asia. So that's why you see all of these magazines coming in later on, diba? Nung 1990s and 2000. So my plan was I won't bring Sports Illustrated, I won't bring all Cosmo, or I'll bring in Playboy magazine. That was my plan. Okay. Rabuti na lang God, in his goodness, laughed at the plan and pulled me out of that dark plan. And instead, through this concert, I went to concert promotion. I brought a friend and I, a partner and I brought Gary Valenciano to Cagayan de Oro City. And this is the way that God really brought me to him. And to make a long story short, I thought that everything I could put my hands to, I thought I had the Midas touch, so anything that I would do at that time, parang it was making money, it was becoming successful, except this. So my friend and I, we got Gary Valenciano to promote our store, Teed. We were also into retail. Dami talaga namin pinapasukan. Tapos, so sabi ko, oh, sige, magko-concert man naman tayo, we might as well bring in the best. So we were thinking of that time, Eraserheads, Lea Salonga, but God's plan was, napunta sa amin si Gary Valenciano. And instead of just promoting one night, we were so greedy, we said, okay, let's do two nights. And what happened was, long story short, we were the most successful failure in Gary V's history of concert promotion. And the Coliseum was half full or half empty, depends on the way you look at it. And I remember just, you know, counting the money as it was like, the concert was 6:30, pagdating ng 6 o'clock, wala pang tao, para it just looked like a dress rehearsal, konting tao. And, you know, anything and everything that could go wrong went wrong the days before that. Okay. But I was thinking, maybe we'll just break even, because I remember I was banking on this sponsor who we had sold at least half of the tickets too, and that would make break even. Pero right before 6 o'clock, before the start of the concert, there was this mestizo-looking guy. I said, "Hey, this is I think kausap ko na ano a sponsor." He ran towards me with a big duffel bag, and he said, "Catch!" Binato niya sa akin yung duffel bag. Ako naman sinalo ko. Tapos pinuksan ko yung duffel bag. Pagbukas ko, lahat ng tickets na binenta ko sa kanya binalik niya. And he ran away. So my heart just dropped to the floor, I started to get nervous and started to count all the money that we had lost, my partner and I. And I went in to the Coliseum. Nangalahati naman siya, pero I knew that wala, all my life savings went down the drain, all that work. But then I heard Gary V sing that song that most of you probably know, "Take Me Out of the Dark." And when I was singing that song, I didn't know that it was Bible-based, diba? When he says, "Teach me to trust in you with all my heart, to lean not on my own understanding." Diba? It's from Proverbs Proverbs 3:5, di ba? And it just, you know, the word of God just cut through my heart. And I remember just weeping and crying. I was weeping and crying at first because of all the money that I had lost. But I found myself just weeping and crying because I felt that the Lord really speak to me and said through the song, I won't give you anything that you can't bear. You know, just trust in me. Trust in me with all your heart. So I went backstage after the concert. I apologized to Gary and told him that I'm so sorry that I failed you. And I wasn't counting the money that we'd lost, but I said, I'm sorry we failed to put more people in this concert because your message is so wonderful. And I felt that, you know, that something was happening to me. By the time I got back to Manila, this was in Cagayan de Oro City, I remember going home to a mountain of bills, credit card bills that I had charged in preparation for the concert. And I was looking at the bills and I said, wow, I can't pay all of this. And with the losses of the concert and the promotion, instead of making money, we were in debt, seven figures. And I was just 20-something that time. And then I said to myself, at that time, you know, I wasn't a Christian. I said I wanted to bring home Playboy magazine. I was thinking of becoming a Taoist because when I did my research, sabi ko, oh, okay tong Taoism because I could have multiple partners. I could, you know, play the field. I could have many marriage partners. So I said, I'll be a Taoist. And I was dabbling in New Age, etc. But somehow, in that moment, I remember just crying out and saying a simple prayer. I said, God, if you're real, can you take away this heavy burden from my chest, from my heart, because I can't handle this by myself. I remember lying down on my bed and waking up after saying that prayer, and this, it was like a wind that just blew in the that blew by the room, and all of a sudden this heaviness in my heart just disappeared. I said, God, is that you? At that moment, my then girlfriend, who became my first wife, my late wife, knocked on the door, looked in and said, oh, I'm leaving you. I thought she was leaving me for good. But she said, where are you going? I'm going to a Bible study. And that time, CC had Bible studies in Makati, along Reposo. And I went there. You know, she didn't even invite me. I went there on my own. And that's where I heard, you know, and that's where God's word became alive to me. I was thinking of not paying my debts. Hindi ko na babayari yung mga people that I owed for the concert, sila Gary, yung mga suppliers, etc., the hotel. But then when the Bible teacher said, turn to Romans 6:23 or 33, I turned to Romans chapter 10, and God just led my eyes to this verse that said, let no debt remain outstanding. Wow, God is talking to me. And I was thinking of suing my partners, and then I turned the Bible, and the Bible would say, and forgive your enemies. Love your enemies. So the Bible became alive, and all I heard at the end of the Bible study was the invitation by the Bible teacher. It was an invitation to receive Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I did that. And my life has never been the same after that. Okay. So that's how I became, that's how I started to know the Lord. So I got married to my then girlfriend in 1995. 5 years later, we started. We were working together as partners. We had a direct selling business, but she became ill, very ill. She almost died of lupus. And instead of that stressful business, we decided to start up a venture called Salt and Light Ventures, a training company. Okay? We started small. We started organizing small workshops, 15 to 50 people. Then it became, once we got the hang of it, we started organizing bigger events of 100 to 250 people, bringing in speakers from Hong Kong, Singapore. And then really by God's grace, he would send people to us, would ask us to help them put together events. And then we put this event together, foreign speaker Tom Peters. If you're in management, you would know him. Then, you know, the events became bigger and bigger. Until in 2004, we brought in John Maxwell, and we were the first ones to organize a seminar in Araneta Coliseum. And when I look back, 10 years after the concert failure, you know, 10 years later, God really blessed us so that we could really put this together in the Araneta Coliseum. And 10 years after that most successful pay failure na nilangaw yung aming venue, God blessed this business because He brought in 14,000 people at the Araneta Coliseum. And I remember that night when John Maso looked at me, he said, "Oh, Ardy, you want me to share the gospel?" I said, "By all means, okay, cool." And so he, even after his seminar, his talk, he even shared the gospel and invited people to have a relationship with Jesus, with God. And back to back, at PICC the next day, 18,000, another 4,000 people. And kaya kami nakilala, we won awards, set up spin-off companies like Inspire, where I partnered with Francisco Buchimenez and Anthony Pangilinan. And then we were awarded one of the 10 outstanding entrepreneurs. So in my work journey, I'd like to share with you, you know, from gardener, ballet dancer, test subject in the army, to entrepreneur, what have I learned? That's what I want to share with you. At least 5 lessons that I've learned along the way that you could depend on, that will make you dependable, okay, whether you're an employee or an entrepreneur. How many of you here are working for someone, are employees? Okay, most of you. How many of you here are in business for yourself? Okay, couple. All right. So yun. So what I've learned along the way is this. First of all, bosses hire for attitude, or they'll keep you because of your attitude and not just your aptitude. Okay. And if ever they will train you, the training that they'll give you is for skills. Because at the end of the day, the boss would rather depend on a person with a winning attitude. That's what he would depend upon. Okay. Sabi ni Dennis Waitley, the winner's edge is not in a gifted birth, a high IQ, or in talent. The winner's edge is all in the attitude and not the aptitude. Attitude is the criterion for success. Dennis Waitley is also a Christian author, and he wrote the book Empires of the Mind. Okay. Before I go to that. So, when people ask, how... I want to have a staff who's motivated, you know. How do you motivate people? When you're the boss will put together a team of motivated people by hiring people who are already motivated to work. Okay, because if you hire someone who's high in aptitude, but yung attitude niya is a 1 or a 2, no matter what kind of motivating you do, you're going to like hit a blank wall. So sa hiring process pa lang, hahanapin na ng mga bosses who know this. Someone who has attitude. I experienced someone, she was very high on skills, very high in aptitude. She came from the corporate world, I hired her. And wow, in a month, you know, she was picking fights with people. She couldn't get along with people. And in 6 months, we were finding ways to let her go. So it's attitude, not aptitude. Okay. There's a recent article in New York Times that went viral. It asked a question, what kind of virtue are you developing as workers? Are you developing a resume virtue or skills or a eulogy virtue? Ano yung eulogy virtue? Yan yung mga virtues that are talked about. Okay, let's hear. So yung resumes, ito, the resume virtues are the skills you bring to the marketplace. The eulogy virtues are the ones that are talked about at your funeral, di ba? Whether you were kind, brave, honest, or faithful. Sabi ni David Brooks in New York Times, okay? So many of us now are clearer on how to build an external career than on how to build inner character. But it says here, but character is necessary to the success of the working person and the organization. A lot of internal organizational issues, okay, which are costly and stressful than most external ones, lie on the ability of employees to govern themselves well and work harmoniously with a variety of people. These things are dependent on one's character and Say it with me. Attitude. Okay. So question, ask yourself, were you hired because of your aptitude or your attitude? Can your boss or coworkers depend on you for important work? Are you that go-to person? Because let's give it to Joe, because bigyan natin kay Jose kasi kahit anong problema niya, grabe ang attitude niya, winning attitude. He's gonna make this impossible job work. Okay. If not, does your attitude need working on? Second realization or second insight. Okay. Do you want to transform yourself? Do you want to give yourself a work makeover? Okay. I realize that if you change your mind, you can change your life. Let me explain. Okay. What does the Bible say? Can you read this with me? Do not. You're reading it with too much passion. Baka medyo nabibingi na yung katabi nyo. So let's try to be more calm, okay? Again, do not. How many of you would like to know, would like to test what God's will is in your life? Right? So it says here, not to conform to the pattern of this world. The pattern of this world. What is the pattern of this world? Okay. Negativism, criticism, putting people down. But it says here, be transformed by what? Renewing of your mind. I like the, this is the NIV version. I like the New Living Translation. It says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. But what should we copy? Okay. But let God transform you. You see, God is the ultimate transformer. See? Transform me into a new person. By what? Changing the way you think. Biro mo yon, you can become a new person by changing the way you think. This is what Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says. And then when you renew yourself by transforming your mind, you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Okay? And many times, many people will say, I want to know God's will. I want to know God's will. But if you don't renew your mind in the Word, it's almost impossible. It's impossible to know His will. And when you read the Word, and when you copy God, you become a godly person, then that's you happen to be transformed into a new person. And that's a big realization. Okay? Sabi ni William James, one of the greatest discoveries of my time is that a man can change his life by changing his attitude. Okay. So friends, okay, what are the thoughts that you dwell on every day? What are the things that you know, there's this term called have you heard the term metacognition? Metacognition. Metacognition is thinking about what you think. So, so every day, sulat mo, ano bang iniisip ko? Then you think about, ano bang iniisip ko? Iniisip ko yung mga iniisip ko, ito yung mga iniisip ko. It's called metacognition. So you study, what are my thinking patterns? What is my thinking behavior? Okay. And the Bible is so rich in advice in terms of telling us what we should think about. Because King Solomon said, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 23, verse 7. As a man thinketh his heart, so is he. So, ano kung ano daw iniisip mo, ikaw yun. Parang, di ba, there's a saying, what you are, what you eat. Okay? But the Bible says, you are what you think. And that's it. What do you think about most of the time? Okay? What do you think about most of the time? What are the thoughts in your mind? What do you think about most of the time? Naisip nyo na ba yun? There was a study on worry that I wrote about in my first book, yung Buhay na Hindi Bitin, and it says that 40%, these are the statistics, 40% of people are worrying about things that never happen anyway. 30% are worrying about the past, decisions that they cannot change anymore. 12% are worrying about illnesses. These are the hypochondriacs, okay? 10% are worrying about, when these are parents, about children and friends who are able to take care of themselves. So, only 8% are worrying about real problems. 92% ng mga primer problema daw natin are things that will never happen or are out of our control. Diba? So, today, nami na nagpapadala ng ano? Are you on the fault line? Diba? Sino mga nakakuha ng mga texts or mga Viber messages na gano'n, naku, I'm on the fault line. Tapos you start, naku, I'm just 1 kilometer away, I'm 4 kilometers away. Naku, ano mangyari? Diba? You start worrying. Diba? And it starts to overtake your life. But we're not supposed to worry because Paul said to the Philippians, let's read this together, don't worry about, instead, and tell God, if you do this, which is far more wonderful, so simply lang, di ba? Sabi ni Paul sa mga Philippians, don't worry about anything. Kahit ano, kahit yung malapit yung fault line sa bahay mo, huwag mo na intindihin yun. Instead, pray about some things, everything also. And what will happen? You will experience the peace of God that transcends all understanding. Hindi mo maintindihan kung saan galing yung peace na yun. Galing, di ba? So don't worry. Pray. It starts with your thoughts. Di ba? So the difference between sumpa, say sumpa, or pagpapala. Yung katabi mo ba, mukhang sinumpa o pinagpala? Pinagpala naman, di ba? It's the difference between blessings and curses, and it begins with your thoughts. Di ba? Grabe, di ba? You sow the law of sowing and reaping. You sow a thought, that thought becomes an action. Lagi mong iniisip, di ba? Naging action. Di ba? Lagi mong iniisip yung magnum. Yung mamaya, bibili ako ng magnum. Mamaya, kakain ako ng magnum. Mamaya, kakain ako. Diba? Tapos mamaya, binili mo na nga yung magnum, kinain mo yung magnum. Okay? Then, you reap an action. So, when you sow an action, you will reap a habit, di ba? So mamaya, naging habit na yung pagkain ng magnum after every dinner, di ba? Naging habit na siya. You sow a habit, what happens? You reap a character, okay? When I say, di ba? Your habit is to be always late. And it becomes, that habit becomes part of your character. You now become someone who is identified with tardiness. It's part of your character. You reap a character. Now you sow that character and it becomes your destiny, they say. And it all begins with the thoughts in your mind. So, anong gamot sabi ni Paul sa mga Philippians? What should be in our minds? Let's read this together. Finally, whatever is true, whatever is noble, right, pure, think about such things. And in the workplace, the Harvard Business Review said that when supervisors started thinking excellently, started having higher expectations on their workers, their productivity started to increase. Pag wala pa silang ginagawa noon, iniisip pa lang nila yung mga dating inaakala nila, dati pag mapapasok yung worker, eto na naman si Taman, o eto na naman, nako, palpak na naman to. Yun. But they started to change the way they look at their people by thinking, I'm gonna expect that this person is gonna reach his potential. I'm going to expect better things from this person. And just by expecting, the people started leveling up to those expectations. And it's true. That's what Paul says. We have to think about whatever is true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, anything that is excellent or praiseworthy. Yan ang pag-iisipan natin. Di ba? Hindi chismis. Di ba? Okay. So the first lesson is Attitude is better than. And second is? If you change your mind, you can change your life. Okay. Number three is work hard for? Work hard for Jesus. Okay. He is your boss, whatever job you have. If you're having a hard time at work, if you don't like your boss, don't resign. Compliment him, you'll get married to him. No. Work harder, respond by working harder than anyone else. And this, I have to say, in the workplace, there are bosses there who are Christians. We get to talk to each other, we own businesses, and then we compare notes, and they say, you know, minsan na, ito yung realization nila, mahirap din mag-hire ng mga Christians. Because Christians now are very kampante. They tend not to work their butts off. Okay. Say, oh, overtime tayo, hindi. May Bible study ako eh. I have to minister. Okay. But even here in CCF, we teach that before ministry, you gotta do an excellent job at work. You are an ambassador of Christ. You represent Christ. People know you as a Christian, and you're playing hooky. You're on your cell phone. You're navigating Instagram, etc. during work hours. It's not giving a good name to the Lord. But if you realize that you're working for Jesus, diba, things will change. So I went to Titus chapter 2, verses 9 to 10, and parang ito, guidelines for Christian employees. Okay, number one, it says, slaves, sakit pakinggan, no? Diba, slaves? Pag employee ka, slave ang tawag sa'yo nung araw. Okay, slaves must what? Obey their masters and do their best to what? To please them. They must not talk back or steal, but they must show themselves to be entirely trustworthy and good. Then they will make the teaching about God, our Savior, attractive in every way. So it's all about being a good example because they're looking at you because you represent the gospel. So a self-assessment. Ask yourself, do you obey your boss always? Do you go out of your way to please your employer? Do you argue, talk back, or talk behind your boss? Ask yourself those questions. Sabi sa Titus, sabi sa Bible, wag eh. Do you pilfer office materials? Have you ever brought home a paperclip? Bond paper? Pen from the office? Have you stolen time from the office by going on social media while at work? Can you be trusted with the little things? If you can't be trusted with a paperclip, ma? If you can't be trusted with the little things, you can't be trusted with the big things. Verse 9 says, they must not talk back or steal, but they must show themselves to be entirely trustworthy and good. The purpose is to make the gospel attractive. People are looking at you. Okay. But umulit. Okay. Sorry. So bosses look for people with malasakit. Malasakit meaning parang iniisip mo, they call it in the secular world, they call it malasakit, they call it as if you're an owner. But malasakit for me is because may malasakit ka kasi ang boss mo, si Jesus. You're working for Jesus. You're an extra miler. I was going to show an example. I was going to show a video of one of Miriam's movies. How of you here have watched Kimmy Dora? Naalala niyo si Kimmy Dora, di ba? Oh, my son has watched that. Si Miriam plays the role of Gertrude, di ba, the secretary. Extra mile na siya. Pag kailangan ng sparring mate sa boxing ring, di ba? nagpapasuntok siya. Nung nasa isang, there was an episode, or I think, was it Kimmy Dora 2? Di ba? Pumalpak medyo si Gertrude dun sa pag-organize ng dinner event. And then, Joshua, what happened to your mom when she got thrown out of the car? Pero hindi siya nagreklamo. She didn't talk back to her boss. Next day, she was there kahit may bruises and everything. She still reported for work. Okay. God willing, you don't have a boss like Kimmy Dora, di ba? Okay. So, let's read this together. Colossians 3:23 says, and not for human masters. So whatever you do, whatever your job is, work at it with half of your heart. And then, di ba? All of your heart, no matter who your boss is, no matter if you're having a hard time, no matter even if you don't like the atmosphere, even if you don't like your coworkers, your motivation should be, I'm going to work hard because I'm working for the Lord. He is my boss, not that human master. Okay? And the realization is, if you do your work for Jesus, then your work is your ministry. Therefore, you're in full-time ministry. Do you realize that? All of you are in full-time ministry. Sometimes we have this idea in our head, you know, I'm going to work hard because, you know, this job, I'm just going to put in 9 to 5, and after that, I'm done, and I'm going to go to church, you know, and then I'm going to work for the Lord, and then someday I'm going to work full-time for the Lord. Diba? But you're already working full-time in ministry. You're already working full-time for the Lord. So work hard wherever it is that you are right now. Colossians 3:4 says, again, whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord and to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. For you serve the Lord Jesus Christ. How many of you serve the Lord Jesus Christ? Should be all of you. If you have a job, you serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. That for me was a mind, that was a paradigm shift. It blew my mind. Because admittedly, there are times when you can't wait to get on to the next career stop. Diba? The next dream job. But wherever the Lord has put you in right now, be excellent in it. Martin Luther King said, if a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep streets, even as Michelangelo painted, or Beethoven composed music, or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause to say, here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. Kahit tagawalis ka ng daan, galingan mo. So do you work as if Jesus is your boss in your workplaces? Do you work as if Jesus is your boss? Look at the person next to you. Sabi mo, I work as if what? Blank is my boss. Okay. Something to think about. Okay. And that's all the motivation you read. I'm going to work, I'm going to wake up early because Jesus, I'm reporting to Jesus. I will brave the traffic of Metro Manila. Di ba? Nakakaawa tayo dito, di ba? Just to get to work, we have to brave, di ba? Even before we get to work, it's so much work just to get a ride, di ba? But you're doing it for the Lord, whatever you do. Yeah. God, Jesus had to carry a cross for you, all those miles. Tayo, inaamoy lang natin yung kilikili ng katabi na natin sa jeep or sa MRT. Di ba? Wala yun. So fourth lesson I learned after that is that, you know, work becomes more enjoyable when you start to love what you do. Okay? And when you love the people you work with. Okay? And you can change your mind in terms of how you look at the people that you work with and in terms of the work that you're in. You can love your work. Diba ang advice nila, work, do something that you love and you won't have to work a single day in your life. But wherever you are, love what you do. Love that work and it becomes more enjoyable. Because Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 19 says, let's say it together, to this indeed is what? It's a gift from God to enjoy your work and accept your lot, accept your condition in life, wherever you are. It is indeed a gift from God. Yeah? Okay. I know Steve Jobs is not a Christian, but he said something that really struck me. when he was diagnosed with cancer, not many people knew that. And then in 2005, he gave a commencement talk and he revealed what his motivation was to work, keep on working despite the cancer. And he said, "I'm convinced that the only thing that kept me going was that I loved what I did." You've got to find what you love. Your work is going to fill a large part of your life, and the only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. And the only way to do great work is to love what you do. Okay? That's his take. The only way to do great work is to love what you do. And before this is, of course, you're loving what you do because Jesus is your boss. And he's put you there. So when you find what you love to do, what God has purposed you to do, you'll find in a point in your career, how many of you here are below 30? Everyone. Ayan, okay. How many of you look like you're below 30? Yeah, everyone. Okay. But you'll realize that in a point in your career, diba? So you're really, even if you don't like your job, but because Jesus said you know love what you do, you're working for me. But there will come a point where you realize that you have a certain calling, okay? And you and all that hard work and all those jobs, distasteful jobs, the masungit boss and everything is in preparation for that calling that God has called you to do or to be, okay? And when you find that, that becomes your hanap buhay. Di ba ang ganda ng term ng trabaho sa ng work sa Pilipino, di ba? Hanap buhay, di ba? E pag you literally translate it, what is hanap? It's find, and buhay is life, di ba? You literally find life, you literally find fulfillment in that hanap buhay, in that calling. Okay. How many of you feel that where you are right now is that is your calling? How many of you feel that this is what I know, this is where God has called me? Good. Okay. It's such a blessing, right? To know that you are in the center of God's will, that nakahanap ka, may hanap buhay ka. Nakahanap ka ng hanap buhay. Okay? And when you find your hanap buhay, by doing so, you're actually partly fulfilling the greatest commandment, diba? To love God and love one another. Is it possible to love one another through work? No. Oh, ito sabi ni Khalil Gibran, work is love made visible. When you work excellently, diba? You love your customers. When you work excellently, you love the people you're with. When you work excellently, you love your employer. You don't have to say, "I love you, boss," but by doing excellent work, Your love is made visible. Okay? So, question. Do you enjoy your work? Yes? If not, do you bring joy to work? Or do you bring frowns? Do you bring joy to your work? If you're not enjoying your work, you bring the joy to work. And lastly, lesson number 5. Okay, pray that God will reveal, for those of you who did not yet raise your hand, pray that God will reveal your calling and your life's work to you. Have you ever prayed that prayer? Those who have not, yeah, have you prayed, "Lord, reveal to me naman. Lord, please naman. I want to make a difference. I want to make a difference for you. I want to find that hanap buhay. I want to find life." You know, in the Bible, there's no retirement, di ba? In the secular world, everyone's goal is to reach retirement and to enjoy life. But you won't find the word retirement in the Bible. Diba? People just kept on working in their calling in life until they were either taken away or until they died of old age. Diba? Pero sila Moses, sila Abraham, walang retirement. So if you're going to work as a Christian all your life, might as well pray that God will reveal that calling to you. Okay? We are all members of the church. We're called, we're given special gifts and special skills, and we're all called to deliver that as a body. Okay? So, in other words, you have to reach that certain that stage in your life when you will be true to that calling and say, God, okay, you've given me these gifts. I offer that to you. I'm going to be a good steward of that gift that you've given me, and I'll work my tail off for you using these gifts. Okay? And for me, I'll share with you my journey in closing. Before I found my calling as a writer, as an author, ang dami kong pinagdaanan, di ba? I showed you all those lists of work that I did. And before I finally really jumped into being an author and writing books, it took some dramatic, some supernatural, incidents or events in my life. I remember one day when I was reading Purpose Driven Life, and I was already in a successful entrepreneur, but I know that the lure, I was doing that because I wanted to make ipon. I wanted to have a comfortable life. But I knew in my heart that the Lord really placed in my heart that I wanted really to write books. I wanted to write, and I wanted to write for the Lord. And so one day I said, Lord, while I was reading Purpose Driven Life, Lord, what is it really that you want me to do? Ano mga gagawin ko? And I was reading the Bible, and the Lord just led me to this verse in Psalm 26, verse 7. And it was so funny because I got a copy. Alam mo yung mga book sale, yung mga nasa kanto ng mga mall na daming tape. I bought a 50 peso Bible, New King James Version. And it just so happened, yan ang nabuksan kong Bible. And in that version, this is the only version that says this. When I was asking God, what do you want me to do? And ito, dito natin punta. Pagbukas ko, Psalm 26, verse 7, that I may publish with a voice of thanksgiving and tell of all thy wondrous works. Sabi ko, grabe. Until now, tumataas pa rin yung balahibo ko when I remember that moment when I was asking God what I should do with my life. But even if I had received this word, after I received this word, I published the first booklet that I published by myself, yung Buhay na Hindi Bitin. Pero sige pa rin ako sa negosyo. Okay? You know, I was still in doubt. For those of you who are in doubt of what God has called you to do, maybe there are certain clues to your calling. Okay? And it's called flow in the world of psychology. And my friend Anthony Pangilinan, I don't know if you attended his seminar called Sense. Okay? So, there's this positive psychologist. His name is Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. Okay, he's Czechoslovakian. Okay, and he wrote a book called Flow. And I don't know if you can read it, so I'll read it to you. And it says, according to positive psychologist Mihaly, I won't pronounce his last name anymore. Flow is a state of complete immersion in an activity. He describes the mental state of flow as being completely involved in an activity for its own sake. The ego falls away and time flies. How many of you had been in activity when, wow, tapos na yung araw? 5 o'clock na, bitin pa rin ako, I wanna work more, di ba? Yun, time flies and every action, movement, and thought follows inevitably from the previous one like playing jazz, okay? Your whole being is involved and you're using your skills to the utmost. That's what he calls flow. How many of you have experienced that in your work? Na minsan hindi na kayo nakakalimutan mong kumain kasi you're in a state of flow. Di ba? There's this book that really, you know, pierced my heart. It's called Wild at Heart. And there's this, it says there, he also was at the encounter, truth encounter, and he says, don't ask yourself what the world needs. Ask yourself what makes you come alive. And go do that because what the world needs is people who have come alive. Okay? And that, when I was reading all these books, it would speak to me, sige na, magsulat ka na. Okay, so where do you find yourself? Are you in a job na pinili mo or pinilit ka lang? Pinili ba siya o pinilit? Because success without happiness or fulfillment is the saddest and biggest failure of all. So, going back to SENSE, okay? SENSE is short for, it's an acrostic, and I give credit to my friend Anthony for this. And the C stands for, can you say it with me? Contribution. Has your work in the past produced has it produced? Meaning, have you achieved because of that? Has it been recognized? Has your work contributed to an organization? Okay, that could be a clue that you are in your calling. If the work that you do, your skill has contributed. E is for excellence. Are you good at what you do? So, you're saying that if your mind can conceive it, you can achieve it. But if you don't have the skills to be excellent at it, before I remember when I was growing up, I wanted to be an NBA basketball player, okay? But I don't have the height or the speed, so I have to really, realize that that's not for me, okay? And I remember when I was also called to be, when I was an entrepreneur and I was writing books, nangarap pa ako maging senior golf pro. Diba? I wanted to go practice golf and be good enough to join the seniors tournament. Pero hindi, walang excellence. Eh. Tuwing magto-tournament, kahit anong practice ko, wala palpak eh. So, how about you? Are you in a place where you are excellent? Diba? Dami-dami sumasali ng American Idol, diba? Yan ang pangarap nila. Pero when you hear their audition, wala talaga. Pumapalpak, pumapalya. Okay? Do you have natural talent at it? That's the N. Okay. Education and training produce many successful people. But so just imagine when your natural talent is further sharpened and enhanced by training and actual exposure. And the T is, do you have passion for it? Are you turned on by it? Actually, passion is not just, energy, and it's not just, ganado ka, but passion comes from the root word, Latin, pati, which means to suffer. Are you willing to suffer for that job that you're in? Okay, that's why it's called the passion of Christ, because God, Jesus, was willing to suffer for you and for me. Okay, and S, okay, yung papasukan nyo ba, is it spirit-led? Have you sought God? Have you heard from God? Okay. So when all these four things fall into place, then you can be more confident. Okay. For me, it wasn't really a formula. For me, it was a mountaintop experience. Literally, in 2005, after we had produced that very successful John Maxwell event, I was so stressed out. It was so successful, but I was super, uber stressed out. And I wanted to sell the business na nga after that. I remember in 2005, in November, my first wife and I, Ting Ting, we went to Israel. And we went to Mount Carmel. And there's a Mount Carmel School of Ministry there. And so I went to this School of Ministry in Mount Carmel. And it's the highest mountaintop in Israel, Mount Carmel, where you can see Syria, Jordan, Egypt, everything. And they have a church there. If you have a chance to go to Israel, make sure that you go to Mount Carmel Assembly. It's a church there. And so I found myself in that school, and there was this pastor. I've never met him before. His name is David, Pastor David Davis, who was a Broadway actor and was called by God to build a church in Israel. He went to Israel because he heard God tell him to build church there without knowing anyone. And he met together with these other Jewish, Messianic Jewish people. Their Messianic Jew is a Christian. Okay, in Israel, they don't call Christians Christians. If you're Jewish, you're a Messianic Jew. Okay, that's a Christian for them. So he teamed up with these Messianic Jews or Christians, and they set up Mount Carmel. And in Mount Carmel, they were teaching about Elijah. That's where in Mount Carmel, that's where Elijah faced the false prophets, diba? So the study was about Elijah, and I remember Pastor David Davis talking about obedience, the obedience of Elijah and his courage to obey God, and he encouraged people to just pray to God what God wanted to do in their lives and the direction that they were going to take for God's glory. And I remember praying, and while he was even speaking, I was asking God, God, am I doing what I am called to do for you? Because I was recounting what I've been doing. I've been successful in organizing all these big events. The business is successful. I'm even writing a column in the Inquirer. But I feel that it's not really what I'm called to do. I mean, it's not the kind of writing I'm called to do. And then I just pray, God, can you reveal to me what you want me to do? And then the lesson finished, and then I remember Pastor David saying, okay, go to the altar, just pray, and pray to God. And I remember going to the altar, this beautiful altar with 12 stones, and with sunlight coming in the middle where there's a cross, and I was just kneeling down asking, God, please tell me what it is you want me to do. And remember, this is many, many years after Psalm 26, verse 7 was revealed to me, diba? When he said that my mission in life was to publish, diba? And speak of all thy wondrous works. And when I said, God, can you reveal to me what it is that I'm meant to do? What is my calling? And I just, the Lord just impressed upon my heart that I should seek Pastor David and ask him if he has a word for me. So I stood up about to look for him. I was going to look for him, but then before I could go up, there was a hand already on my shoulder in the back. When I looked at the back, it was the pastor, Pastor David. And he just placed his hand on my shoulder, and then he just said, you are a writer. You are a writer for the Lord. And you're going to write for the Lord. And then he left. And then I just felt the Holy Spirit just pierce my heart and said, and then parang sinabi ko na sa'yo, yung writer ka eh, parang kulit-kulit mo eh. Pero kailangan pa may ibang pamagsabi sa'yo, di ba? May word of God ka na, mayroon na ngang. And then I just found myself just weeping and crying and just praising God. And after that trip, I went back. I started looking for buyers for my business. And I started writing again. And that's when all those other books started to be published. Okay? I don't want to make it a very long story, pero that's how, that was my journey. That was my adventure. Okay? And kung yung dati yung buhay na hindi bitin, yung first book na sinulat ko, I was self-publishing it before. And I stopped publishing it because I was asking myself, nung bago ako naging Kristiyano, di ba kwento ko sa inyo na I was a Hugh Hefner wannabe. I wanted to be the Playboy publisher of the Philippines. God was already chasing me at that time because I remember when I would go to Greenbelt in Makati, and Greenbelt 1 lang noon, wala pang 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, there was a food court there, and I would see this group of Christians. I knew they were Christians because they were giving away tracts. Okay? And when I would see that, in my mind, ano kasi ako eh? I have got this friend who became a born-again Christian, and he would share with me. He's with CCF, actually. And then, tuwin magsishare siya sa akin, alam mong sagot ko, ikaw born again, ako born against. Ganun ako. Eh, kasi nga, ambisyon ko maging Playboy publisher ng Pilipinas. So, tuwin, and then I remember that group dispersing. Tapos, nag-distribute na sila ng tracks. So, ang ginawa ko, di na ako kumain sa food court. Kumain na lang ako sa pancake house na malayo doon sa food court para hindi ako lapitan. Pero paglabas ko ng pancake house, the leader of the group, actually, kilala ko siya. Alam ko siya. I mean, kilala siya kasi he was the lead singer of Side A before he resigned and became a Christian and did his thing. So he approached me with a gospel track, and he said, "Hi." I thought, "Hi, may abo siya." That's why I'm a Christian. Tapos sabi ko, "Hi, I'm busy." Tapos tumakbo ako. So ganun ako, tinatakbo ko yung mga Christian kasi yung mga nagbibigay ng track. So later on, God has a sense of humor. Pinagsulat ako ng track. Tapos ako ngayon naghahabol sa mga tao, nagbibigay ng gospel track. And I would publish my own gospel track, Buhay na Nibitin. This is not how it looked like before. It was just a flimsy, parang handout lang siya. Tapos I would give it to people wherever. Gas station, restaurants, spa, basta lahat ng pwede kong puntahan at pinamimigay ko. And I would ask God, "God, ito ba talagang calling ko?" Eh parang wala naman nagbibigay ng encouragement sa akin, wala naman nagsasabi na nag-working in track. And so I remember one day, God encouraged me when I said, God, encourage me naman. Give me naman some kind of encouragement. I prayed that prayer that morning. And in the evening, my first wife nga, my late wife, Ting Ting, went home and she made kwento. May hindi siya sa spa yan. So nagkwento siya, oh, I met someone at the spa, yung receptionist. Tapos, alam mo, nakakatawa kasi sabi niya sa akin, ma'am, ano mo tong writer na to? Pinakita niya yung track, yung Buhay ng Bitin. Si Ardy Roberto, oh, kasawa ko yan. Ah, ma'am, pakisabi naman, thank you, kasi kagabi, naglalakad ako pa uwi, hahanap ko ng bus, tapos depressed ako, hindi ko lang ang gagawin ko sa buhay ko. Tapos may nakita ako sa daan. Pinulot ko. Ito, yung booklet, yung Buhay ng Bitin na sinulat ng asawa mo, meron nagtapon na iba. Tapos, ma'am, binasa ko sa bus, talagang na-touch po ko talaga ako. Tapos pagdating ko sa bahay, alam mo po, nag-pray po ako. So, nag-pray daw siya to receive Jesus Christ. Tapos, biro mo yun, parang I just prayed that morning for God to give me encouragement. And then that evening, He came back, my wife came back with that story. And so, it gave me encouragement to persist. And then when we published the new edition, I got a letter from a princess. Okay, ito yung letter niya. Sabi niya, good day, I'm Princess from Pateros, Metro Manila. Pangalan niya, Princess. Okay. So si Princess, nagsulat siya sa akin. Ano siya, guidance counselor. Hindi ko nababasahin yung buong sulat niya. But she said that, thank God, God used this book to open my heart. I thank God for touching my heart, for just simply saying that He is there for me. So, yun, God kept on giving encouragement through letters, through etc. And then after that, I wrote The Heart of Healing. It was about the healing miracle that God created in our lives with Ting Ting. Si Joshua, later on, yes, that's Joshua, you know, he went to me, itong pinaka-fulfilling sa akin kasi he got the gospel track and then he went to me one day and said, Dad, pag-uwi ko nung gabi, sabi, Dad, can you sign my book for me? Yeah. Pa-autograph daw. Can you sign it for me and my stuffed toy, Mangkito? Yeah, si Mangkito. And so I signed the book for him and then, alam mo, so Joshua, you know what's in this book? So we read the book together and I had the privilege of leading my son into an acceptance prayer to receive Christ when he was 4 years old. Yeah. Praise God. So the books, you know, and began to have a life of its own, ministering to people. The Heart of Healing became a curriculum for doctors, for interns. Okay, help means hope, encourage. You heal by giving hope, encouragement, love, and prayer. So there were doctors who were actually implementing these four things in their hospitals, and they saw cancer patients na gumagaling, okay, because of this. And I would receive letters from doctors. Ito si Dr. Elmo Lago. And he said that their program was inspired by the book, The Heart of Healing. So, yung nga yung sinasabi ni Anthony, di ba? You have found your calling if you have contributed, di ba? If you found that, you know, may excellence in your work, di ba? That you have natural talent for it, okay? Etc. Okay? But you know what? Despite the certainty of my calling, I was matigas ang ulo ko. Okay? And I knew that God was calling me there, but I still had doubt. And how many of you have you've heard from God, but you still have this doubt and you don't really go out and obey right away? Diba? I can see some heads going like that. Diba? Kasi nagtatanong tayo, Lord, okay, pero how? Diba? How am I going to fulfill that calling? Pero, you're not supposed to ask the question, how? How is the area of God? Okay. God's promise, I listened to this pastor, and he said that, you know, if God gives you the vision, He will give you the provision. You don't ask how. You just obey. If you had permission to do what you really want to do, what would you do? Don't ask how. That will cut your desire off at the knees. How is never the right question. How is a faithless question. It means, unless I can see my way clearly, I won't believe it. I won't venture forth. When the angel told Zechariah that his ancient wife would bear him a son named John, Zechariah asked how, and what happened? He was struck dumb for it. How is God's department? Diba? He is asking you what? God is asking you what? What is written in your heart? What makes you come alive? If you could do what you've always wanted to do, what would it be? You see, a man's calling is written on his heart. That's from John Eldridge in Wild at Heart. So I knew already God had spoken to me through his word. God had spoken through me through his servant. But you know the temptations of the world when you have that calling? And I became like a Jonah. I became like a Jonah. Diba si Jonah sinabihan na to preach in Nineveh? Pero ang ginawa niya, he went the other way. And that's what basically I found myself doing after some time. I found myself doing a Jonah. And instead of diving into that calling with all my heart, I found myself, like Jonah, being swallowed by a whale. Okay? And in my life, I've experienced being swallowed by a big fish. Okay? I remember one time after receiving that calling, I postponed. I would say, Lord, sige, I'll do one more big event, one more. Last na to. That's another year. Lord, promise. Last na. Another year. Lord, talaga promise. Ito na talaga. 2009, talagang magsusulat na. Last na to. But I just have to do this big project. And you know what happened? I got swallowed by a big fish. I remember one night, God just dealt with me. I couldn't sleep. And I would have what you call ultra hydrosis. I forgot what it is. Or hyperhidrosis. It's when you sleep at night and you wake up because you're drenched in sweat. I had to change my pajamas 6 or 7 times a night kasi nagigising ako punong-puno ng pawis yung damit ko. And I consulted a doctor, and when I did my research, and I had acidic stomach, when I did my research, I knew that it was stress and then I had to take off. And so finally, I heeded God's calling, and I was spit out, and I ran away from the world to detox, and be still, and to pursue my calling and write. And so I went to I prayed, God, would you give me naman a place? Kasi our condo then in Makati, there was construction, there was like construction going on, there was like this condominium being demolished, hindi ako makasulat. So I said, Lord, bigyan mo naman ako ng place that where I can write. And I told my wife, my first wife, about that, and we prayed together that he would give us a place in Tagaytay. And you know, God is really a miracle working God, because in 24 hours, he showed this friend of a friend of a friend had a burden to not rent this place in Tagaytay, in Highlands of all places where I really wanted, but I said, we can't afford that place. But my first wife just really prayed. And you know what? God answered her prayer, because we got a friend of a friend of a friend said, okay, we know this place and we know that you're looking for this place to go on sabbatical. And to make a long story short, this person went to us and said, you know, we don't know why we're giving this place to you, but it seems like we've never done this before, but here's this place. Just take care of the place and just pay for the upkeep and play the upkeep and all of this. It usually costs $120,000 a month to rent, but they gave it to us practically just for the maintenance. And we stayed there not just for 3 months, naging 6 months, but we stayed there for 14 months in Tagaytay Highlands. It was one of the best times, and I was able to write, I was able to enjoy. In between that, I went to Kenya, went to this literary conference for Christians, and met some pretty nice animals like Alice, this giraffe. But pag uwi ko from Kenya, I started itching. And a week later, I found out that I had a parasitic infection. Not from kissing the giraffe. The saliva of giraffe is, you know, if they could bottle the saliva of giraffe, it could be sold as hand sanitizer. Ganun kalinis yung... So you don't get parasites from kissing a giraffe. So hindi naman ako pinanished for kissing someone other than my wife. But I remember running in the gardens of Kenya in some of the fields there. And nasugatan ako. And then I got this plant and I just pinahid ko siya. Tapos sinabi, dun ko raw nakuha. Anyway, by the time I got back to the Philippines, I was itching all over. I really felt how Job felt, you know. And I was scratching my chest, and then hindi ko na mamalayan, dumudugo na pala. When I would scratch my back by going, alam mo yung mga aso, pag nasa tabi ng concrete wall, tapos gagarang-garang sila. Ganun din ako, gumagarang-garang-garang ako. Ang kate, it was one of the worst experience of my life, having parasitic infection. But the Lord used that because I got too comfortable in Tagaytay, I was getting complacent, I was playing more golf than writing, and then while I was itching away, the parasites would wake up from 2 o'clock in the morning hanggang 4 o'clock. So nagigising na ako. And then habang nangangati ako, ano kaya susulat ko? Nakita ko yung buhay na hindi bitin. Tapos nangangati ako. Di ba mayroong kasabihan ng mga lola-lola natin na pag nangangati yung palad, anong may perang darating. Sabi ko, ba't hindi kaya ako magsulat tungkol sa pera? Pera na hindi bitin. So yun, I wrote an outline. Sent an email to my publisher and they approved it. And while I was in Tagaytay, eto, na-publish yung pera na hindi bitin. Yun. And yun, nakipag-away ako sa publisher na gawing 50 pesos. And because I really wanted more people to read, kasi yung mga libro noon about financial stewardship was like 200 pesos, 300 pesos. And really, God really blessed that because, as I said earlier, my mom didn't really buy 149,000 copies. You know? But it's really God's work. So yun yung mga challenges and conflicts in discovering. And many times in 1 John 2:15, it says, "Do not love the world or the things of the world. If you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you." And I found myself that really the tension between your calling and your work, what God is really because, you know, you love the world and the temptation of following what's in the world more than God's calling is there. But the final straw was really when my first wife passed away. When Ting Ting, my first wife, was diagnosed again, she was healed. In 2012, bumalik yung lupus niya. And the hospital became her mission field. And we found ourselves sharing the gospel to the doctors and nurses in her last 6 months of her life. And when she would ask me, why, have you spoken to God? And what's God's message to you? And why is this happening? And I would tell her, yeah, in my quiet time, God would tell me that this is happening because he loves us so much. And that he wants us to go after this. We're not going to be the same people. And we're going to go on a higher level of service to him. You know, we're going to follow our calling. And at that time, she said, Ting Ting said, yeah, you know, God has been speaking to me also. And I realized that, you know, I had made the business an idol. And I've been working too hard in that business. And God has been calling me somewhere else. And God did call her somewhere else because on January 5, 2013, God did call her to heaven to be with him. And my first wife died in my arms. And I remember... that experience, I said, I can't be the same person anymore after this experience. Life is short. I gotta really follow God's calling because, as David said, teach me to number my days so that I may have a heart of wisdom. Our life here on earth is so short. If we don't use these follow whatever days are remaining in our life to do what God has called us to do, you know, we're gonna live at your deathbed. You're not going to regret, you know. You're not gonna regret working overtime. You're gonna regret not following God. You're gonna regret, you know, not loving enough. You're gonna regret not forgiving this person or that person. And so, you know, God spoke to me. The purpose of all that happening was calling me to a higher level of service, both of us. And God promised me that, in His word that my mourning would turn into dancing. Okay? He promised me that I would love again. He said that weeping may last from the night through the night, but joy comes with the morning. And he would, whenever I would worship, and he would tell me, you started the year in grief and mourning, but you're going to end it in joy and a new morning. And His promise to us, to every one of us, is that He will give us everything that we need. And for me, I didn't know that I needed, in my mind, I was going to be a hermit and I was going to be single for the rest of my life. But God knew better, that what I needed was a new life, a new beginning, a new partnership. And when God told me that I would love again, I said, how, Lord? I don't even know how to make legal anymore. I don't even know how to court. It's been 17 years of married life, 5 years studies, 20 plus years of not knowing how to court. How am I going to court? So He led me to write the book, Real Men Are Pogi. I said, okay, write this book. This is how you make legal. Okay, you be pure. You pursue purity. You be obedient to my commandments. You be a gentleman. You be intense in your relationship with me, even before anyone else. Okay, and you'll be handsome in my eyes and in your God's best. And so I wrote that book because in preparation, because God was telling me that I would love again. So that was in preparation. And the book came in handy because when the time came when God revealed to me who that God's best was, inga, di ba? Nothing is impossible with God, di ba? Pinagsama kami ng dalawa. Yun. So that's, and going back to the topic about work, and I found that God is so amazing because He's put me and Miriam together because she has become my work, my workmate, my work partner, my helpmate in our ministry, in our business, in everything that God has called us to do. And I'm so blessed with her because we complement each other. If you hear our love story, you know, it's really amazing how God put us together because we were the last people we had in mind to be life partners with. Okay. But you could read her book, He Can Catch You When You Fall, and the last three chapters of the book is our life, is our love story. So hindi naman to tungkol sa love story, di ba? Tungkol sa trabaho to, di ba? Kaya saka na yon. Okay, so yon. So where were we? We know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. What is God's calling to you? What are your dreams? Is your dream worth achieving? Is it going to help other people? Will achieving your dream help make the world a better place? And sometimes you have to ask those questions, you know? In the book, Real Men Are Pogi, I tell the story of Edwin Pajes. He once had a business of a beer house that really prospered. But when he became a Christian, he gave up the beer house and the $250,000 a week income that it was making for him. And he was left with 25 centavos. He didn't even have enough to catch a jeepney. And today, God really blessed him for his obedience because now he has this website called... it's supposed to be here, but he has a website, an online real estate website where he helps OFWs find houses and lots. And now his business is worth $250 million just by obeying God. And he feels that that is his calling. His work, because of that blessing, he has established different businesses in different locations. He has also established English tutorial centers in different countries, in Cambodia, where they read the Bible, where people practice English by reading the Bible. So yun po, my friends. So P.S., lastly, choose your friends. Surround yourself with the right people. Make sure you're with not corruptors, but cheerleaders. Insulate yourself from negative people. Because Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20 says, read this with me as we close. He will be wise. Be destroyed. Okay. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20. Okay. And that's why it's so important to have a discipleship group. It's so important to have a mentor. It's so important to plug yourself into a small group. And if you're not yet part of a small group, if it's your first time here, then find someone, that group that you can plug yourself in. Okay? So, I know napasarap yung kwento ko. There are a lot of kwentos that I didn't really mean to share, but I hope you appreciated it. And if you have any questions, if you want a copy of this presentation, just send text or email me at that email address. And within the year, I'll send it to you. Basta kulitin niyo ako. Okay? So again, the five, if you remember the five lessons in my life journey, you know, please go home and write it down and ask God what it is that He wants you to do. And if you're in a job right now that you're really not enjoying, you know, lift that job up to the Lord and dedicate it to Him. Work for the Lord with all of your heart until God really reveals to you what your specific calling and that hana buhay is. So I really, my prayer is that you've taken something from here.